couple of announcements as well. The first one is related to the Oregon State Beekeepers meeting. This will be November 6, 7, and 8 at Seaside. I have a copy of program that I pass around and copy of the registration also pass around. Basically, the best way to access this and then register if you are so inclined is the Oregon State Beekeepers website. It's orsba.org. That has all of that information, including profiles of the speakers, and then short summaries of the talks of the speakers. So we can start this around while I'm working on some of the others. There's four in all. So. We'll post it, okay. Second way of announcements, there is going to be, there's a new book, some of you have seen some reference to it already, Bee Time, Lessons from the Hive. The author is Mark Winston. Mark has been the professor of agriculture at Simon Fraser University, and midlife decided to do something different and then took on the task of teaching honor students to write at Simon Fraser University in Vancouver. And so no longer is doing bee activities, but he has a very interesting writing style. I think you might find this of interest. Let me say from the book chat, read from the book paper here.
Flat,
okay. Being among bees is a full body experience, Mark Winston writes. From the low hum of tens of thousands of insects and the pungent smell of honey and beeswax to the sight of workers flying back and forth between flowers and the hive. The experience of an apiary slows our sense of time, heightens our awareness, and inspires awe. Bee Time presents Winston's reflections on three decades spent studying these creatures and on the lessons they can teach about how humans might better interact with each other and the natural world. Well, why I'm indicating this is the date, Monday, November 17th, at 7:30 at Powell's, the one on Hawthorne, Mark is going to have a bee signing. And I'm sure we'll get to have a chance to have him read from at least another excerpt. He has been doing that at some of the meetings. So here's a flyer, again, just to pass around, but to get this on your radar, perhaps, of this event. Third item that I have, and again, I can't find my slide series. It was that I had all there. Some of you have participated in the Bee Informed Annual Loss Survey. That's different from what we presented to you here in the club. This is the electronic survey, now in its fourth year, but going back another additional 3 years. That survey reports on annual losses and then has a management survey as a backup. And so we have some students now working on theses to try to take several years of data that you have supplied. Last year, over 200 individuals in Oregon did participate in that annual survey to try to find some correlations. We solicit a lot of information from small-scale beekeepers. We get some commercial beekeepers, such as people like George, to also provide information. But the vast majority of individuals are small-scale. We'd like to return some additional information to small-scale beekeepers, so we have started a new feature on the Bee Informed. It has now only been three two-week periods, so a little bit less than 2 months, called Hive Check. Hive Check. If you go on the Bee Informed website, beeinformed.org, it's that simple, go on that website, you'll see a series of boxes across the top, and one of them will say Hive Check. And what you can then do, going in Hive Check, is sign up And every 2 weeks, you will get a very simple survey to fill out. And then we will return that information, and you'll get the information back within a week of having completed a survey. I'd like to encourage small-scale beekeepers to join that hive check and to participate, do as many of the questions as you feel you want to do. Yeah, Mike, you can maybe pass that around the hive. Now make sure it gets back to me, please. We're going to put a review of that on the website, okay, or on all the media for the pub group. I'd like to encourage you back to HiveCheck, encourage you to participate in that. And you may not want to answer all the questions. There are not complicated, usually yes or no. And we're going to, over the winter season when you're not doing as much active bee work, perhaps get some other questions. And then we will summarize it. The more that we get for, I'm doing a report on that for the Pacific Northwest beekeepers. The more participation we get, the greater the type of information I can feed back to. So that would be some of the useful information on that. Finally, the representative from Happy Valley introduced a legislation to the Oregon legislature last year to ban the use of nicotinoids. That bill was not passed, was not voted on, but rather as a substitute, a motion was made and passed to form an Oregon task force to report to the legislature to look at aspects of what we might do to try to improve honeybee health here in Oregon. That task force has been meeting diligently. George Hansen is a member of that task force. Dr. Ramesh Sagili is the chair of the task force. The representative that introduced the legislation from Happy Valley is a member. There's a senator, there's a member. A member of the Zierse Society is a member. It's about a 10, 11 person committee.
Eight members,
and then a chairman. They are now in the final stages of drilling down their recommendations. Perhaps some of you heard something on public radio this past couple of days about one possible legislation. The other one, and I didn't bring it up here, in the bee line is perhaps they're investigating the opportunity to the Oregon Department of Agriculture to return to an active inspection program that would include also a registration of bee colonies. So they're coming up with these recommendations, and the idea is that this will then perhaps go to the legislature and perhaps then form the basis of some legislation. And that would be our opportunities as individuals with our own representatives and senators to perhaps have the opportunity to influence that legislation. We're going to hear more now in the next month as they're wrapping up this, their task force. And so I urge you very strongly to keep on top of that. And for those things that seem to be in line with the way that you feel we should be keeping bees and doing bees in Oregon, we might then want to encourage that it then develop further in the legislature with some teeth behind what the task force itself is recommending. So I urge you to keep on top of that. This committee has worked very hard all summer to try to come up with these recommendations. Where exactly is this information? The basic report will very quickly hit the media because it is a legislative task force. So I think that will be our first way to hear it. George, is there a better, where else should we try to keep in touch with this?
Well, I'm just looking at internal documents, which are for discussion only so far, but it seems to me there is, and what I'll try and do, I remember if not someone remind me to get information to Tim. Somebody, I know there's somewhere on the website where you can get draft minutes or minutes of the meetings, and I'm just going to say right now that at least the recommendations, they have to go to the legislature, and then the legislature has to act on some. In other cases, the Department of Agriculture can act without legislation. I think we will see reinvigorating the registration program for bees, and the money from that will go to research, and there will be a heightened amount of outreach and education for applicators and pesticide users. It seems unlikely because of political considerations that there will be any restrictions on any particular chemicals or any additional licensure or anything like that. There may be some other changes, but this is politically charged. The wish to identify all the locations of all of these in the state of Oregon, I don't think it's going to get through. It's too expensive, and I think that the inspection programs as proposed probably won't happen because it would be such an expensive to have that many inspectors and so forth and so on. But there will be money going towards, I think, and this would pass, just for how to pay for it, increased help to beekeepers in terms of taking samples and having them analyzed either by someone coming to you or you taking a sample and sending it in and having an analysis done on it. So I think that's, rather than have inspections, it is more likely that there's going to be help for beekeepers in identifying problems. That's real quick and dirty. But it all has to go through the legislature.
And this is especially appropriate when we talk about the fall, because as George indicated, we need to be monitoring for the levels of mites and then perhaps making decisions based on that. All right, I do have it. Okay, here's the B-book signing. There's the conference, and this is that high check. This is the type of report that you will get. These are the types of questions related to, did you inspect? Did you feed? Did you see swarms? And then this shows some representation. We're also trying to drill this down as to the size of your, we've come up with another term, hive years. An expression of how many hives you now have times the number of years you've been a beekeeper. As we looked at the pub data, and I and Andrew and myself looked at the pub data, there's a very strong correlation with experience and increased survivalship of colonies. In other words, less winter losses. And so this high years may be a way to try to get at that, so that we might identify those that are just the beginners, 1-2 years, 1-2 hives. With this multiplication of those two factors, I think we can begin to separate that. One of our strengths with the Bee Informed is that not just giving you undigested numbers, we've sought to try to do some analysis on those statistically so that we're not saying just trends or just what's happening, but real numbers and getting the information back real time. So I hope you might consider, it'll come every couple of weeks. If you want to answer the questions or not, that's fine. If you want to answer only some of them, that's fine. It's not going to be taxing that way, but I think maybe this information, and I'd love to have your feedback if it's something that you are finding that is going to be useful, something additional. Okay. All right, our seasonal perspective, of course, these are our graphs that George largely developed. As we have indicated, it all depends on what's available out there in the environment. So we are very much in diminishing nectar flow. As the brood decreases, colony consolidates, and hopefully defends against robbing, and then into the next phase, which is this dormancy. So we're very much into this diminishing and nest consolidation time of year. George and I are on the same page when we talk about a number of these things. He said, I was taking notes about what he was saying. I do all the time because I always learn from George, but we always are on the same page too. So what do those successful colonies look like? Can colonies be too strong? We say strong, populous colonies, but there are some differences. Young, vigorous queens seem to make a difference. And now we have opportunities to look in terms of trying to put in survivor stock, selected hibernating stock, certainly healthy brood, the lack of this snot brood, the parasitic mite syndrome, and adults that are virus-free. Enough honey, how much is enough, and stored pollen or bee bread, and again, how much is needed. And so what you should be looking at your colony right now is a food chamber on the colony, one or more food chambers, and a brood chamber on the colony. And in that brood chamber now, in sort of normal-sized colonies, we might find bees occupying about five or six frames, of which most of them would have some brood on them, not solid frames like in the summer. And then to the sides of that, some honey, and then scattered throughout that cluster and above it, some stores of pollen. So that is our ideal. That's what we're after in terms of the colonies. Okay? And so how can we help achieve that? Well, now until the weather closes in, we really don't have a lot of options. We don't have much that we can do. Now, why is overwintering challenged? George has gone through this. We don't have a native bee. Oregon is without a fall flow. The environment is going to throw curves at us. Bee mites, that relationship is not a good one biologically. And some would suggest that it's an issue with the Langstroth hive as well as a creator of some of these problems. Certainly the way we manage Langstroth hives does indeed give us some problems, or can give us some problems. Whether that means we all return to skeps, here's a skep upside down with the four natural combs or not, is a personal choice that we make. And so a number of people are trying things such as top bar hives, return to an old hive, a very hive, etc. The bees know best, so they don't need our care. And a number of beekeepers believe that. But if you'll take a look at this colony that's set up after they had swarmed, this happens to be in the barbecue, notice what is lacking. There are no honey stores there, okay? So do they in fact know best, okay? Does in fact this type of structure from a natural bee tree, can we capture that in our hive better than a Langstroth hive? And the short answer is yes, but then is it something that we can manage? So our hive is a compromise, certainly, no question about that. So our biggest option right now is feeding carbohydrate, feeding sugar. We can use in-hive feeders. Here we've removed two frames with a feeder. There are some that are just one. You can get this in plastic or natural materials. Top of the hive feeding, various jars. This is over the intercover hole. Here we've taken the intercover away. We put three cans, peanut butter jars without removable lids, holes poked in the lid. Right now, you've got to force the bees to feed. And so not one jar, but several jars at this time of the year. I guess I pressed back somewhere there. Okay, there we are. This is a method preferred by a number of bees. I think these are George's bees here. Another boom top bee.
That's Sowers.
Chuck Sowers, past president of the Oregon State. And you see the modified lid, not the telescoping lid, a hole drilled in it to accommodate the jar lid. And so you can just remove those and put another one on just as quickly without bees escaping. And of course then some sort of a high top feeder. The bees come up through from their frames below, climb up here, climb up to the edge of this feeder without drowning, are able to take feed. There are some good feeders. What you want to avoid with feeders like this and high top feeders are feeders that bees drown in. If those bees have pathogens, bad pathogens in their body, we all have pathogens. If they have bad pathogens and they fall in and they then get soaked up by all that sugar water, and that's the trough the bees are feeding on, that can't be good. I mean, that's against all kinds of rules of sanitation, isn't it? So try to avoid feeders in which bees accumulate. Many people don't like the in-hive because you've got to go into the colony, disturb a little bit. So feeders that you don't end up disturbing the colony perhaps are the best one. And as indicated, now a heavy syrup. And don't skip on them. Try to get as much into the bees as you can. Another one is the Ziploc bagging. If you find your bees aren't taking it, give them a reason to take it. Buy the very expensive spread, something like Honeybee Healthy, one of these supplements, something with smell in it, and mix that into your feeder, okay? Bees just don't intuitively know necessarily. You put feeders on top. So put something inside them that they do. And for example, when I put feeders like this right on top of the top bar, I let it drip on out of the feeder initially as I'm putting the feeder on. So they're sitting there, some drops of sugar water that I'm trying to feed the bee as I flip over that can or I flip over my jar. And the purpose of that is, again, not trying to surprise the bees, trying to let them know, communicate with them. Girls, this is what I'm doing. I'm adding a feeder. Your responsibility is to take this down. I went through all the work of going to Costco. I bought it. I mixed it up. Now it's your job, okay? But don't surprise them. Okay, try to communicate with them. Other options, of course, many of you with some beginning outfits get this entrance feeder. This is not where the bees are, as you saw in the diagram, so that is the least effective of the feeders. It also often means that you've got a larger entrance there, and this may promote robbing by other bees and the yellow jackets. Another, fill an empty comb. And finally, the last option is just feedlot feeding. Put out a great big container, as big as you can afford to lift or move around, and just keep pouring syrup into it. Just keep pouring syrup into it. When you go out to replenish it, you got to go out early in the morning or late at night because it will be a mob scene around the feeder. Just out. Now, the disadvantage of that is the colonies that really don't need it are the ones that are often there. The colonies that really need it, the weak colonies or the ones low on stores, never get the message, hey, there's a free giveaway of syrup out there in that big container. They never get that message. So with all of these are advantages. This one works, but remember these are very tiny cells. There's a heck of a surface area, so you've got to get it into the cells. So for every gallon you pour in, about two-thirds of the gallon run down on your boot. So you got to pluck that back and keep pouring it back, try to get it into the cell. The feeding supplements can make a big role here, and that is, again, getting the bees to take it. That is your role, to communicate with them so they actually take it. All right? And so that's where these type of materials do come in handy. And if nothing else, you're buying expensive sugar syrup in a nice, attractive bottle. Now, the natural way, if you want, is to leave bees. So here we are. These were actually my dad's bees. The box here did not have enough feed in the feed chamber, so we left the other box that we might have used as surplus, as harvest. With shallower supers, this might be a shallow. So again, they set up their cluster, but they set up here. This rotten box is pretty much a walkthrough. So they set their cluster up here in this box, and so there was not enough of a feed chamber on the colony. So we left a feed chamber. So these frames were taken from other colonies. Again, this could have been honey we could have harvested for surplus. But in this case, erring on giving the bees more or at least enough to get through the winter. So actually feeding with honey. Do not go out, you've heard this before, do not go out to a store, do not go out to a source and buy honey and feed it to your bees. You just don't know if it is contaminated with the spores of American foulbrood. And the chances are that it is. So you might be giving them an inoculum for the disease they can't handle. But if it's your own honey, that will work. Now, earlier in the fall, we could have done this, and we could have actually scored these frames here, just made a real mess in this box. And the bees would not like that. And so what they would do is they would go and they all that oozing honey from where we made the mess in the cap frame, they would actually pull that down into the box. If we get, like this weekend, a nice day, a nice weather day, and you have that, you can actually do it on something like where we're going to have a couple nice 3 days in 80 degrees. And again, score that. Make sure there's no way for robber bees to get in, so make sure it's secure. If you've got upper entrances, close them at that point and let the bees pull that down into the brood area. OK? Okay. So those are all things that we might or we can be doing.
Yeah. Assuming you're also getting rid of queen excluders at this time, so that...
We're getting rid of queen excluders, so there's no queen excluder between there. So what is going to happen in this colony, in fact, did, this cluster moves up. So then in spring, we got two walkthroughs, almost virtually empty boxes, with almost all the bees there in the top box. So we've got one little extra step of work to do in the spring. It's not a big step, because we'll pull these out. Actually, we'll start reversing these in the spring. These will be ugly, moldy cones. After the bees move away from this lower box, when you look in that in March and April, that's ugly. It's moldy, the pollen is often moldy. There's a smell to it. There's a wetness to it, sort of a greasiness to it. It's pretty ugly by that time, but again, the bees will start taking care of it pretty soon. Now, for those with alternative hives, in the article I wrote about working towards treatment-free, the guru of alternative hives took me to task, took me out behind the barn and gave me a whipping in his article in a subsequent Bee Culture magazine. And one of the things I indicated, one of the problems we have with alternative hives is the convenient way to feed them. And why I pointed out it is not at all inconvenient to feed these things. All you need is a blue trash container, and you just tape it to the outside of the box. So it's no problem feeding these bees. Or you take the blue trash container and you move it right in the box, right up to the cluster. That article, I stand corrected, these things are very, very easy to feed. As you can see, all you need is the blue trash container.
Does it have to be blue?
It has to be blue. Of course, if you've got a nice window on the outside of this, you can look in and you can see where the cluster is, and then you can completely violate the whole concept of a top bar hive and put something like this in there. But this is easy to do. Okay. Now the other part of feeding, and George has alluded to this as well, is protein. The larger scale beekeepers will feed an incredible amount of protein. George, just as an example, 5 years ago, is there any comparison in how much protein you're feeding now, extra protein versus then?
Certainly 7-8 years ago, we were at a pound or two per hive one time a year, and now we're over 15 pounds per colony, and we're feeding heavily in the spring and in the fall.
Spring and the fall, and feeding heavily. There are many ways to do it. Some people are trying to mix this into the sugar syrup, for example. Scientificbeekeeping.com, Randy Oliver has just recently compared the ones that are available commercially to feeding just plain pollen versus feeding nothing, the negative control. So go on that site and take a look. He compares about six different, Nutri-Bee, Mega-Bee, V-Pro, the Global Patties, all the commercial ones that are readily available. And it turns out that actually these things often outperform pollen, just plain pollen, which is this positive control, and all of them very much outperform the negative control feeding nothing. And there really isn't an awful lot of difference between them.
Just remember that that I'm a commercial beekeeper and we keep large numbers of bees, and very often the forage is not sufficient naturally in their flight rate, so we have to supplement for that reason. We're working counter to the cycle of the weather. We have to have really good bees on February 1st, whereas you probably don't have to have really good bees until, June 1st. A lot of the stuff we do are lousy locations for bees. You get paid to be there. So, I mean, we're trying to do something that I don't think, is maybe interesting to you, but I'm not necessarily advocating that all of you should go out and invest heavily in this. It can create a monster, too. Some of this, you might create hives that are just ready to swarm, and just because they grow so fast under those circumstances. So I just want to say that cautionary thing. We do this because we have to. It's our business, and we're bees under extreme circumstances, where for you, you know, these are tools, but you probably don't need to be investing the way we are.
And precautionary tale, well said, but with George, be careful of what you wish for, okay? If you are going to be feed heavily with all these materials and want a strong colony, what are you going to do with a strong colony? Are you in February, or what are you going to do with it? So in terms of our backyard, we generally, as George indicated, have very good spring pollen. Where we maybe have that deficit is later spring. This year, for some reason, it was all the way into June where we had those unusual starvations in the foothills. And also then in August. So those might be windows to feed. But if you do want to stimulate weaker colonies, et cetera, the feeding of protein. And again, in hive, the key secret to all of this is, again, bees don't recognize that you're getting soy flour, and soy flour, you know, tofu is a great thing to put into our stomachs or their stomachs, okay? They don't recognize it. So either put pollen in with it, or we put a lot of sugar in with it, and of course we put it right where the bees stumble over it. Don't make it any secret to them. So put them right where they can get at it. Again, there is some feedlot feeding recommended by some, so these are great big tins of a dry powder protein material. Unfortunately, again, the stronger colonies are the ones that will tend to find that and then take advantage of it as well. But again, once considered unnecessary, now much more commonly done. But again, for every intended consequence, there's an unintended, at least one, an unintended consequence. So you're going to build stronger colonies, so you need to have by the end of that. Then, as we've indicated, moisture is our real enemy, not the cold. So feeding after November, we've got to go to a solid feed, such as the candy board. Here we've mixed up sugar, we made it into a solid candy, like a rock candy. We put it into a rim, in this case a box, and by putting it right on top of the frames, the heat and moisture from the bees comes up and makes a slurry where the bees are in their cluster of some part of this so that they can actually take it. Otherwise, this rock hard stuff, they can't drill into any more than we can, break your tube trying to get into it. And then as an emergency, even dry sugar poured here on the inner cover. This is a further north, and you can see there's a winter wrap, just a light tar paper around the column. Driver sugar, driver sugar is what is favored by our bee retailer here in the state, but in many cases it's just granulated sugar. One of the issues may be they will take some of this and then seem to throw it outside, so they might not utilize it. But we need to support the sugar cane growing in the anyway. So the more they throw out, the more we're supporting it.
Quick comment about driver sugar. So driver sugar is partially inverted, which makes it into a simple sugar, and the bees take it very readily. I'm talking about the brand name CNH product, driver sugar, that is being sold by our local guy here. When we use it, we actually pour it onto the bees on the 1st of January in order to break the cluster, because it forces them to eat it, it creates heat, it breaks the cluster, they become active, and they'll take our pollen substitute at a time in the dead of winter when you want your bees to be absolutely quiet. Now, if you're using driver sugar, it will do the same thing. It will create heat, it will make the bees break their cluster and be active, and they will become even more hungry. Actually, it's like eating celery, I guess. You use more calories eating celery than the celery gives you. When you use driver sugar, in effect, you're actually burning more calories than you're giving, and you are creating a monster. So I think, really, honestly, that your candy board of bees, or if you have to, dry sugar doesn't have anywhere near the stimulative value of the driver. And driver is a great tool, but I think that using it as winter feeder is a bad choice.
And again, this is emergency, so we shouldn't be thinking of emergency until they really need that sugar. So in November and December and January, they're pretty much in cluster most days, and they're not rearing very much brood. So the amount of food they'll go through is really minimal. Now starting in February and certainly in March, now they really will ramp up, particularly with some false signals from Mother Nature saying spring is closer than it was last week. They will then start ramping up, and that's when they really go through their feed. And so that's the time I'm thinking emergency feeding, not November, December, January.
What about dryer sugar right now?
You know, as with George, I'm not a real fan of that particular sugar, so I kind of avoid saying a lot about it one way or the other.
You know, it's very, very expensive, and for if you're just trying to give them carbohydrates, dry sugar is probably a fourth the cost, and I don't think there's any reason. They can still take syrup right now, and that's the fastest way for them to gain weight.
Yeah, syrup is the fast way. We still don't have that moisture stress issue yet, and you're going to take care of that because then what you're going to do is do something about all that moisture. In this case, we have an extra rim on top of the colony, the inner cover here. Even without the inner cover, then leaving this stress, we're going to put this above some pennies or some carpet tacks so that we get a venting of that moisture, and maybe then fill that up with a moisture-absorbing material. So that's a best thing that we could do in terms of our colony. That is our enemy here, that moisture stress. Okay, those are some comments. Are there some... Tim, do you want to make the announcement, the exciting announcement for next month?
Well, there's a couple of ones. Which one is that?
No, you go ahead. It's our November meeting.
November meeting is the Wednesday before the meeting opens up in Seaside, so it's November 4th. And, no, 5th, I'm sorry, November 5th. And one of our speakers coming to Seaside is stopping here first. So that Wednesday night, we're going to have Kim Plott, the editor of Bee Culture Magazine.
Woo!